just feeling that breeze, singing like a song through the tall oak trees. It was just another summer night, had to be the last thing on my mind. Yeah, I was all but lost in the moment. I was young and running wide open. It was just another summer night, had to be the last thing on my mind. When love said I'm yours, the first time I called you Lord.
Welcome to BFC Online. We are super excited that you chose to worship with us today. Now, BFC family, let's continue in worship.
Worship our King. Come, let us bow at His feet. He Yeah. Good morning, BFC. God is good.
All the time.
And all the time?
God is good.
Yes, he is. Thank you very much. Just like we've been doing, I'm not going to go over the announcements today. They are on the slides at the beginning of the service, so you can go back and pick those up there if you missed them, and they're available anytime. You don't have to listen to me to get them, so that's a good thing. I do want to say, though, that the giving statements for 2020 have been mailed out. If you did not get yours, or if you don't get yours pretty quickly, you can give the church office a call and they can track them down for you, okay? The other announcement that I'd like to make is, has been sent out in an email, but just to make sure everyone knows, a near unanimous vote was taken in favor of calling Pastor Wren and Sarah and Noah to be the BFC's next pastor, and they accepted. And so the Wrens will be our next pastor. Right now, the current plan is to have their first Sunday here March 7th. Again, that's penciled in, it's not chiseled in, but the way it looks now, that will probably be that way. We are responsible, BFC is responsible for moving them from Washington down to here. And so if anyone would like to help with that, contribute towards that, if you would mark in the memo portion of your check, or announce it some way that this is for the moving fund, then that would be great, and it will go towards that. You want to make sure that your email address is correct. If you've been receiving emails and being kept up to date that way, then it's correct, of course. If you've not been receiving emails, can you please give the office a call, the church office a call, and make sure that your email address is correct. As the move becomes closer and the first Sunday is decided for sure, that will all go out on an email. We'll try to keep you informed as to what's going on in this transition via email. And those of you who don't get email, there will be phone calls, just as we have been in the past. So just check to make sure you're getting your emails, if you would, please, okay? That's really all I have in the way of announcements. Just really exciting that we have a pastor on the way, and that's a good thing. So just be in prayer, if you would, for both churches, the churches he's leaving and the church he's coming to, and that the transition will be a smooth one, and that they will find a new pastor, and that Pastor Wren will fit in here, and God's in charge, God's in control, and God will fit him in, but prayer just always helps. You can't go wrong with prayer. So if you wouldn't mind doing that, we'd appreciate it. And speaking of which, we're going to go to prayer right now. So I'll say a short prayer, then we can all recite the Lord's Prayer together, and we'll continue with the service after that, okay? So let's go to prayer. Father, we do thank you for providing the next pastor for BFC. Father, we pray for the church that he's leaving. We just pray that they would find the correct pastor for them, the pastor that you want for them, that they would come to you, and that you would help them to find a pastor that they need. And we just pray for the transition for Pastor Wren and Sarah and Noah. Just pray that the transition is an easy one for them. They have a safe and easy move, if there is such a thing as an easy move. But we just pray that you would protect them and guide them, get them here safely, and that BFC would just show the warmth and the love that we are towards them. Father, COVID is still going on. Strange times. We don't know. We don't know what the church situation will be when they get here. But Father, you do. You are in control. We say this every week, and we mean it. We trust you. We thank you for being in control. We thank you for guiding, protecting us. We just pray for those who are suffering with an illness, whatever the illness is. We just pray that the symptoms would be mild and that they would feel your loving arms around them as they're going through that. Pray for those who have lost loved ones in this time, for whatever the reason. Just pray your comfort to them. Father, we pray for the churches involved in this transition. We pray for this community. Pray for this state. Pray for the United States. Pray for the world. We've turned away from you. And I say this every week, but we know, we've read the book. We know what happens to nations that turn away from you. And Father, we do not want that to happen here. So just pray your patience on the United States. Find a way to bring her back to you. And we just pray that revival will sprout out and that she'll come back to you so she can remain a great nation. Father, I just thank you for being the kind of God that we can come to, we can give our worries to, we can give our praises to, and you love us and you take care of us. And Father, we just thank you so much. Father, we ask all these things in the name of your Son, who taught us to pray. And everyone said, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Thank you, BFC. Please be in prayer as we go through this transition. Now we'll continue with the service. Thank you.
Hello, everybody. It's good to be with you again. Today we're going to be studying on in our theology of ministry, and we're going to be looking at the primary property of ministry. And in doing that, we're going to go to the Gospel of Mark, chapter 10, verses 35 through 45. You turn in your Bibles and read, follow along with me as I read chapter 10, Mark's Gospel, verses 35 through 45. Then James and John, the sons of Zebedee, came to him. Teacher, they said, we want you to do for us whatever we ask. What do you want me to do for you? He asked. They replied, let one of us sit at your right and the other at your left in your glory. You don't know what you are asking, Jesus said. Can you drink the cup I drank or be baptized with the baptism I am baptized with? We can, they answered. Jesus said to them, you will drink the cup I drink and be baptized with the baptism I am baptized with, but to sit at my right or left is not for me to grant. These places belong to those for whom they have been prepared. When the other 10 disciples heard about this, they became indignant with James and John. Jesus called them together and said, you know that those who are regarded as rulers of the Gentiles lord it over them, and their high officials exercise authority over them. Not so with you. Instead, whoever wants to become great among you must be your servant. And whoever wants to be first must be slave of all. For even the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve, and to give his life as a ransom for many. Jesus doesn't mince words with his disciples. He tells them plainly in this passage that the essential ingredient in ministry is servanthood. Because you see, when we begin to serve someone else, that's when we are beginning to minister to them, truly minister to them. The disciples wanted Jesus to do their bidding. They wanted power, recognition, position. They were asking to be served. They didn't understand why Jesus came to them. They didn't get his mission yet. The disciples' motives involved taking the place of Jesus. Self-service, their pride produced that kind of an attitude in them. They weren't really willing to lay down their lives for Jesus or for any other person, as far as that matters. Seems to me that above all else, Jesus' motive for serving always was divine love. And so the context for our loving enough to serve must be the same humility like the humility of Jesus. That's Christ-likeness. That's the kind of humility that Jesus demonstrated. Galatians 5:13 says, serve one another in love. Philippians 2 verses 1 and 2 proclaim, be like Jesus. It's simple, folks. No love equals no humility. No love equals no action. No love equals no ministry. So the big question that needs to be asked is this. What keeps you from serving other people? What keeps me from serving other people? Is it because we don't love like Jesus loved? I've been asked frequently how we in the church, who have different views about religion and politics and lifestyle and about just about everything else you can think of, can exist together in the same church fellowship. And I've only got one answer: Jesus and his love. Jesus served even when he knew his death would be caused by the unbelief of those he was serving. That was God's love in action. W.A. Criswell was the pastor of the largest Baptist church in the world in Dallas, Texas at one point in time. And he was visiting in Chicago at the North Shore Baptist Church as a guest preacher one Sunday. And while he was at that church speaking that Sunday, he met James Kraft. Kraft was the superintendent of the Sunday school at that Baptist church. But during the week, he was the founder and president of Kraft Foods. Dr. Criswell heard James Kraft say, I would rather be a layman in a North Shore Baptist church than to head the greatest corporation in America. My first job is serving Jesus. You see, James Kraft, as a young man, had a desire to be the most famous manufacturer and salesman of cheese in the world. Probably all of us have eaten some Kraft cheese at some point or time. Well, Kraft planned on becoming rich and famous by selling cheese as a young man with a little buggy that was pulled by his pony named Patty. After making his cheese, he would load his wagon and he and Patty would drive up and down the streets of Chicago to sell their cheese. Months passed and Kraft began to despair because he was not making any money. In spite of his long hours and his hard work, he was almost destitute. One day he pulled his pony to a stop and got out, walked around to him and said, Patty, there's something wrong. We're not doing it right. I'm afraid we have things turned around and our priorities are not where they ought to be. Maybe my plan is all wrong. Maybe we ought to serve God first in our lives. So James Kraft and Patty, his pony, went on home, and when they got home, Kraft went inside and he got down on his knees and he made a promise to God that day that for the rest of his life, he would first serve Jesus Christ by serving other people. That's what we call God-centered ministry. And it's always described and defined as love in action. The word for ministry in the New Testament means to serve. And guess what? The word to serve is a verb. And that verb means that the word serve is a call to action. Words for that Greek word are serving or to serve or of being a servant or being in service. And those words or formulations of those phrases appear approximately 100 times in the New Testament. In every instance, serving has to do with voluntarily giving up of oneself for the care, for the building up, for the nurturing of another person. The word serving is primarily derived from the example and the lifestyle of the person of Jesus Christ and from his gospel. We read, remember, in Mark 10, verse 45, for even the Son of Man came not to be served, but to serve, and to give his life as a ransom for many. Professor Colin Brown said one time, when we speak of ministry, we speak simply of work done for another, the benefit of which will accrue to the account of the one for whom it has been done. The activity of serving stands in complete contrast to ruling. Faithful service presupposes humility in the one who serves as the inferior, in contrast to pride. He who serves is in a position of dependence, and his freedom is always limited. Therefore, what does serving equal? It must equal love in action. Serving equals love in action. When you're committed in love to the welfare of another person, to their betterment, to their being built up, then you're acting in the love of God for that person, and you are marked by the humility of God that he calls you to be like, just like Jesus. We also read in Luke's Gospel, chapter 22, verses 25 through 27, a clear teaching of this principle. Those verses read, "Don't lord your authority over others. Rather, let the greatest among you become as the youngest, and the leader as one who serves. For who is the greater, one who reclines at table or one who serves? It's not the one who reclines at table, but I am among you as the one who serves." Jesus actually becomes the slave, the servant that carries the food to the table and then waits for the request by those at the table for more to eat, and then goes and gets them more food and serves them again. So let's remember, God wills this to be you. He wills this for you. When Jesus served, it was a demonstration of the love of God in action. So from the example of Jesus, serving is always understood as a personal sacrifice, the taking on of a humbling posture, of stepping into a place that might not be your plan for the day or your objective for the day. But that's okay. Robert Chapman was a great friend of George Mueller of Bristol, England. He asked Mueller one day, "Would you advise young Christians to do anything for the Lord?" And Mueller replied, "No, I advise them to do everything for the Lord." God enabled ministry. It carries with it a ransom attitude. Let me say that again. God enabled ministry carries with it a ransom attitude. What do I mean by this statement? Well, I think it's simple. Jesus was a ransom for you and me, and he gave his life that we might be saved. In essence, serving is saving others. Serving others sees them as so very important, more important than we even see ourselves. And so we give our time, we give our expertise, we give our resources, we even give our actions as ransoms for others because we choose to see them as more important than we are. Remember again the words of Mark 10:45, "For even the Son of Man came not to be served, but to serve, and to give his life as a ransom for many." Jesus died for many. He died for your salvation. He advanced the interests and welfare of every person who's ever lived at his own expense. Serving the way he did was his commitment to helping others to know redemption and become whole persons again, the way they were designed and created to be. And he invites you and me into the action of saving others as we live our lives for him. During the American Revolution, a man in civilian clothes rode his horse past a group of soldiers, and they were working diligently repairing a small defensive barrier. Their leader was off to the side shouting instructions at them, but he was not making any attempt to help the soldiers. The rider stopped and asked why he wasn't helping his men with the job at hand, and the man quickly replied with great dignity, "Sir, I am a corporal." The stranger apologized, dismounted from his horse, and proceeded to help the exhausted soldiers finish the job. When the work was done, The man in civilian clothes turned to the corporal and said, "Sir, the next time you have a job like this and you don't have enough men to do it, just ask your commander-in-chief for help and I will come again to help you." The stranger was none other than General George Washington. Christian ministry is doing Christ's work of reconciliation, but doing it his way. Just like that man outside who keeps pounding on the wall. He's helping. He's serving. Well, that's what we do when we do Christian ministry. We do Christ's work, but it's the work of reconciliation. It's the work of doing it his way. Helping others to come under Christ's lordship. That's helping them to become conformed to his image. Colossians chapter 1 verse 28 says, "Christ we proclaim, warning everyone and teaching everyone with all wisdom, that we may present everyone mature in him." Romans 8 verses 28 and 29, those two verses also express a powerful picture for us to see and understand about this concept. Let me read those two verses to you. "And we know that for those who love God, all things work together for good, for those who are called according to his purpose. For those whom he foreknew, he also predestined to be conformed to the image of his Son, in order that he might be the firstborn among many brothers." Now, I would encourage you to never again quote Romans 8, verse 28, without also quoting verse 29. And let me tell you why I'm making this suggestion. Christians like to quote verse 28 whenever talking about all the stuff going on in their lives. Troubles and mishaps and discouragements and health issues. And how God, well, he's going to make it all work out in the end. But let's be clear what the end is in these two verses. It's not feeling better. It's not somehow getting our bills paid. It's not eventually having the tide turn our way, or getting that new job, or the job we have getting better, or dealing with those family members that are difficult and hoping the family comes together, or any number of other things we would like to have go our way in order to get past our difficulties and our troubles. No, that ain't it. God works all things together for our good according to his purpose. And what's his purpose? Well, that's why you should never quote verse 28 without also quoting verse 29. Because his purpose is found in verse 29. His purpose, according to that verse, is to conform you and me to the image of his Son. Your good, as far as God is concerned, always is and always will be your becoming more like Jesus. You becoming Christ-like. You becoming Christ-oriented. All of us becoming Christ in action wherever we are. This is why a theology of ministry is so important. To see ministry from God's perspective and what he really envisions for us. First, we learn how important it is to submit to the lordship of Jesus Christ. And then secondly, we learn what it means to become Christ-like in every way. To have our character conform to the image of Jesus. So that now, thirdly, we can serve like Jesus. It becomes possible for us to serve like Jesus served because we're submitted to his lordship and we're becoming just like him, conformed to his image. I don't know about you, but this is the question I have for you today. Do you have a life verse? Do you have a life verse? Do you even know what a life verse is? It could be a verse that describes who you are becoming in Jesus Christ. Or maybe you have a life verse that defines why you're following Jesus Christ. Or maybe you have a life verse that proclaims your greatest hope as a believer in Jesus Christ. You know, Christ is the hope of salvation for you and for every person who believes. I have a life verse. I do. My life verse is 2 Corinthians chapter 13, verse 4. And I've put it into my own words that means a lot to me. Here's what it says. 2 Corinthians 13, 4. "For he was crucified in weakness, but lives by the power of God. And I am also weak in him, But in dealing with you, in serving you, I will live with Jesus by the power of God. Helping others become faithful followers of Jesus Christ is what this Christian life is all about. So I'm asking you right now, today, to make some decisions. Just to illustrate that, I'd like for you to get out a piece of paper, grab a pen or a pencil, open your Bible. Maybe you want to write in the column of your Bible. And on that piece of paper, I would invite you to write down, this is just for your eyes only, the names of three people who are now faithful followers of Jesus Christ because you laid down your life in service for them. If your serving doesn't produce faithful followers of Jesus, then your serving is disconnected from the life of Jesus. And it's time to change your life's focus as a follower of Jesus the Savior. And don't be bashful about this as you write the names down. Maybe you only could write one name down. Maybe you couldn't write any names down. I've done this exercise with pastors in pastors' conferences. I've had 30 or 40 pastors in a room. I've asked them to do the same thing. And there have been pastors who sit there, who pastor hundreds of people every Sunday. And they couldn't write down even the name of one or two or three persons that they know for certain are faithful followers of Jesus because they served them personally, individually. I'm reminded of the story of a boy attending a Sunday school class in a Chicago church that I know about. The boy's parents never attended church with him, but they allowed their son to go to that nearby church because the boy wanted to. Then the family moved to another part of the city, a little longer distance from where that church was located. But that boy still attended that same Sunday school. He continued to attend, although it meant a long and tiresome walk each way. A friend in the class asked him why he walked so far to Sunday school because the friend said, you know, I know there are plenty of other churches and Sunday schools just as good nearby your home. So let me ask you, why did you come to a Sunday school now that's so far away? Why didn't you go to one of the churches near your home? And the boy answered him, because at this Sunday school, I am loved. Now I relate to that story very personally, because Mrs. March was my Sunday school teacher all through my high school years. Villa Grove, Illinois. I knew beyond a shadow of a doubt that Mrs. March loved me unconditionally. I credit her loving me for my never rebelling from going to church every Sunday. You see, that's what we're talking about. A theology of ministry firmly rooted in the scriptures is all about God's love for us and his love shining through the lives of each one of his children. So let me review what we've been studying. Here's what we've been talking about. Knowing God's love through his saving of our souls, which moves each one of us to therefore respond to his command to follow him and submit to his lordship in our lives. That's the prerequisite for being and doing ministry. Christ's lordship. That relationship with the Lord of life produces in our lives a transformation of our character into the likeness of Jesus. God starts working immediately when we are saved in making us and conforming us into the image of Jesus Christ. As Romans 8:29 stated it so clearly, conforming you and me to the image of his Son, Jesus the Lord, is God's purpose. That's why he works all things together for our good, that we're conformed to the image of Christ. That's the presupposition of ministry that's required of each one of us. Our character becomes like the character of the Lord who saves us and whom we follow. As a result, now the essential nature of sanctification takes true form and purpose as the property of ministry in our lives. We are the Lord's servants, and daily we are becoming the Lord's servants. He's making us into what he wants us to become. It's going to take a lifetime. So don't get discouraged or don't get downcast because you want to be like Jesus all at once. But it's the day we die, folks, we're going to be still needing to be more like Jesus. Well, there's a wonderful question that I would like to ask each one of you. Here's the question. Has your ear been bored with an awe? Maybe you didn't hear me. Let me say it again. Has your ear been bored with an awe? If it's still not clear or plain, I'll say it one more time. Has your ear been bored with an awe? The question comes from a wonderful story in Exodus chapter 21 that describes how a Hebrew slave who has been purchased is given the opportunity to be free after serving the master who purchased him for 6 years of servitude. There are clear directions as to how this amazing process is to take place in that story. But there is also in that story the description of a unique condition that could develop if the slave plainly says to his master, "Master, I love you. I love my wife. I love my children. I will not go out free from you." And if that happens, then the master must bring his slave to God at the doorpost of his home. And there the master will bore the slave's ear with an awe. And the slave will be the master's slave forever. So I ask you again, have you heard the Lord's command? Have you submitted to his lordship? Have you said yes to that command and followed Jesus? Have you desired for his conforming work in your life so that you could become more like Jesus in humility and as a servant of others? Has your ear been bored with an awe? Father, I pray for every person who's listened to this message, who's been watching, as we've talked through your word, as we've described what it means to be a servant of yours, to be like Jesus, and to be conformed to the way Jesus was and is. And I pray that that's every person's reality here, that we are all eagerly and with hunger and thirst, desiring your righteousness to be formed in us and to become more and more like Jesus. Help us, Lord. Help every person here that we would become committed to serving others so that they too may become fulfilled and willing followers of Jesus Christ, their Lord. In his name I pray. Amen. God bless you, everyone. Have a good week.
Thing on my mind. When love grows. pursue me. I said I'm yours, the first time I called you Lord. You hit the mark.
When
pursue me.